Budget and Finance Committee meeting will begin. The date is September 19th. The time is 7:38. We'll begin starting. Good evening.
Good evening.
Thanks everyone for coming to this meeting. I know it's scheduled a little later than usual. I appreciate everyone's attendance here. First item on the agenda is proposal number 17, which is fixing the salaries of appointed officers and employees of the city of Lawrence, Indiana. Mr. Fenwick must have just stepped away for momentarily. Yeah, so we won't have our controller, Mr. Fenwick, when he comes in to come up and talk to us about, have a discussion about these salary increases. Mr. Fenwick, we're just waiting. We're going to have you come up and talk about proposal number 17.
Sure. Proposal 17 is the Civil City Salary Ordinance. I guess I'll offer up if there are any questions to it. There were some changes made to this. In particular, some of the lower end ranges of salaries were increased, and some of the higher end ranges were as well. Doesn't necessarily mean that's what we're paying, but from an ordinance perspective, I did increase some of those ranges.
Okay. Yes, Councilor Shepard.
Yeah, just one question on this. Over the last 4 or 5 years, in some of the conversations with the auditors every year, there's a resolution that the USB passes, and it allows for the USB to offset or compensate administration employees a certain percent. And my memory serves me right, and I just found it again the other night. I think it's 5 positions, and so controller can get an additional 50%, IT 100% is paid, and it's kind of all over. Mm-hmm. And in a couple of the exit interviews, they said that just wasn't a real good scheme to do because of the lack of transparency, because the council, we set a salary ordinance, but then there's this other resolution that's across the street that could inflate salaries, and that happened actually in the past. And not that I'm in a position where I'm going to say what one person should or shouldn't make. That's not, I don't think, the council's role. So have we eliminated that, and have you kind of baked that into this? So we're not going to be doing that anymore?
That's correct. There's one position in this ordinance that would still have a general fund and a utility split, which that's on page 2 of the ordinance. But every other position in here, this is 100% of what we would propose the salary range be for those positions. So there wouldn't be, take the controller's position as an example.
Yeah.
Well, this is what's coming out of Civil City, and then we're going to rely on this other utility piece. This is what the salary range is.
I'm looking at it on my iPad. I can't see where it's on page 2. Can you just tell me the position?
It's administrative assistant. It's the very first position on that second page. And there's a general fund split and a utility fund split.
Oh, I see it. Okay. Yeah, it's at the top. Thanks. Okay.
So I have a question. So let's take the controller position and the deputy controller position. Aren't you the controller for the USB?
Correct.
And so I want to make sure I'm clear, they wouldn't pay any percentage of the salary into the salary range of your salary?
Well, yes, they would through the internal service funds that we've set up. So this reflects 100% of any salary that will be paid. And then with the allocations of those internal service funds, each department will be paying a proportionate share of that, but we're not getting into a, it's 50-50, or, you know, whatever that percentage may be specifically, because quite frankly, the controller's office serves every department within the city, so every department will be picking up a proportionate share of not just salaries, but the cost of the controller's office.
So how much will the USB be paying on that?
About 30%.
Of the total cost of the controller's office?
Correct.
Where can I find that, Jason? What page?
That is the, effectively, the very last page of the actual budget book.
So you took the 13% from the water utility, the 18% from the sewer, and added that up to approximately 30%.
Correct.
Right. So in real dollars, it's $600,000, $700,000.
And that's not just controller's office. That also is IT services. That's the internal service charge in total.
I want to make sure I give folks opportunity. You guys are good? Okay. I wanted to make sure we were good on that question before we moved on to any other questions. when I went through several of these positions here and compared them to the last, and there are increases approximately in every position. And so I'm just curious to, as we start with Corporation Counsel, there's a $3,000 increase there, but we don't plan to have a.
That's correct.
Okay. Same thing as Chief of Staff.
Correct. Okay. If I could interrupt and explain on those two in particular, those are not filled. We do not intend to fill those. We left those in the ordinance because those have been positions that have been filled in the past. And so if there's a future case, you know, we don't intend to fill those, but down the road, you know, we left them in there for that purpose. The reason there's an increase is because of a 3% increase. I just bumped the minimum and the maximum range up by 3%.
Okay.
But there's no intent to fill those two.
You haven't budgeted any money
Correct.
For those either.
Correct. So. There are no dollars budgeted for those two positions.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I guess it's fair to say on the increases that we see, like the Director of Parks, 3,000, those are just 3% increases.
For virtually every position on here, but for controller, deputy controller, and HR director, the rest are effectively 3% or close thereto.
Okay.
The HR director's position, which is currently not filled, the range for that position as it currently stands is less than the range for benefits coordinator, which is a filled position. So our benefits coordinator, in theory, could make more than our HR director if we had one. So in my opinion, in the real world, your HR director should be at the top, and then you would have benefits below that. So I adjusted that range to reflect that.
Do you plan on filling that position?
I do plan on filling that next year, but I'm not going to have two, one being an HR director, one being a benefits coordinator. It'll be one or the other. So in essence, it's a title change.
Right, because our benefits person is newly hired.
Correct.
And I assume that you're happy with her services.
Correct.
So then I'm assuming that you're giving her a title change and an $18,000 raise.
The raise, no. The title change, yes.
Okay, can you explain to me what the raise is then?
For that position, yes. One second.
Because I don't see it on the, is it on this ordinance? HR benefits coordinator.
Yeah.
So it's hourly at the top at $23.80 an hour, but then it goes to a salary position. You know, basically you're taking it up to 65.
I'm not taking it up to 65. The position's hourly currently at about 54, and I'd be proposing to take it to 60 as HR director.
That's what's budgeted.
Correct.
Mr. Chair. Mr. Chair.
Yes.
Could I just another quick question?
Yes.
I noticed on the low end, there's a lot of 47.5, and my hunch is that is in response to the wonderful idea the Department of Labor has about enacting overtime standards for salaries less than, is that what that is doing? Okay.
That is correct.
So you're bringing it up to the minimum, okay, so we won't incur overtime for those employees?
We don't currently have any exempt employees below that.
Okay.
But in the future, if we were to hire an exempt employee in one of those positions, I bump the lower
okay.
end.
Okay, that's good. That's good.
I also wanted to, for the record, to make sure that I'm reading this correctly. If you add in the Corporation Counsel position, which you're not budgeted for, I have that we're approximately increasing about $190,000 in salaries. If you take the Corporation Counsel out, I'm looking at approximately an increase of $102,000 in new money.
Can you explain how you've come up with that number?
Well, I added up the increases, the 2, the 3, the 4, the 37 thousands, and I added those up and it came up with the new dollar, with $77,000 or 73% of those increases being to the controller and the deputy controller. An increase. Because in my approximation, I have an increase raised for the controller, deputy controller of $40,000 and an increase for the deputy controller of $37,000.
So the increase for those two positions is $30,000 for controller and $27,000 for deputy. That's the increase.
Okay.
Based on what the current salaries are.
Okay. I was going off of the top end of the different salary increases from the different salary ordinances.
Yeah, and the deputy controller's salary under the current ordinance is that amount on the max end. The controller's is not.
So did you budget $125,000 yearly income for the controller or deputy mayor?
Yes.
Yes. Did you budget $95,000 for the deputy controller?
Yes.
Okay. But
there are a lot of other positions in this ordinance, you know, corporation counsel, chief of staff, deputy chief of staff, planning and building director, at least those three, those are four that aren't filled, even though the range changed and went up. They're not filled, nor do we plan to fill those. I haven't budgeted dollars for those positions. We left them in here because they, again, have been filled in the past just from an inflation standpoint. If salaries are going up, I wanted those to stay in line for future purposes.
So, but I want to make sure for your, you're telling me your numbers is on the controller and deputy mayor, it's a $30,000 increase, and on the deputy controller, it's a $26,000 increase?
It's 30 for the controller and 27 for deputy.
27. Do you have the percentage of increase that is?
Yeah, can do the math. ...31% on controller and 39% for deputy.
So the only position that is filled, the benefits person is filled, you're going to consolidate that. We don't have any position that is unfilled, that has a budget dollar associated with it for 2017.
I only hesitate because I'm trying to think if we have just a vacant, but we have not, I have not budgeted for any new positions for next year. So okay. The positions that are not filled at the moment will not be filled.
Okay, thank you.
Because I know in this year's budget, we approved a chief of staff that's not filled.
Correct.
And then we also, there was a deputy chief of staff that was funded that's not filled. And I noticed that a city engineer position is not in here anymore.
Was that a filled job in the past?
It was in the salary ordinance.
But we didn't have anybody working.
It was outsourced. But it's budgeted for 15 or 16, but it's not here now. So,
and if I could just add on at least controller, deputy controller, the thought behind that is, number one, setting the precedent to be able to, you know, hire a qualified individual or individuals for those positions in the future. And then two, if you look at, you know, kind of comparables from not only just a government, or at least government as we would think of it, city government, but what the competition for those positions in this area would be, government and school districts. And there are certainly higher salaries being paid to finance positions and lower. In my mind, that was about the middle of the range. So it wasn't just pulled out of thin air. There are some comparables to back that.
Would you like to share some of those with us, please?
Sure. As an example, and I'll just run down some of the, you know, school districts. You have Washington Township, 166,000, Wayne Township, 151, Pike, 138, Perry, 137, Fort Wayne City is 125 and some change. You can get to Indianapolis, which is 115. Obviously, you have some below that. A big difference also in some of the city comparables is just the overall staff. So in Lawrence, we have one controller, one deputy controller, Fort Wayne, as an example, has one controller, two deputies. They have a total staff of 19, excludes utilities. So the controller's office in Fort Wayne just does civil city. Indianapolis, one controller, four deputies, total staff is 66. Carmel, they have three deputies, total staff is 7. You know, South Bend.
So one, tell me, like, if you have, like, Beech Grove, a city that's actually comparable in size to Lawrence. Because I know we use Indianapolis a lot, but it's a stretch in my mind.
True. At the same time, I'd argue, you know, part of it is just the, you know, it's not necessarily size of the city, it's the challenge of the job, to be honest. And I looked at Elkhart and Kokomo as being more comparable. Salaries are lower, staffs are bigger. So, I mean, I tried to kind of run as big a spectrum as I could find. But by and large, I would say that from most comparison standpoints, on just staff alone, staffs are a lot bigger.
How many staff people do we have?
In the controller's office, we have 6.
Okay, so Greenwood is a comparable city, wouldn't you say?
Correct.
And they have a total staff of 9.
Correct.
And their controller makes 87,000. Elkhart is a smaller town, but you know, I would think. And they have 11 staff with a salary of 86. But I do agree with you, controller. I will do believe what Jason said, that the challenge of the job has to be considered as well. Mm-hmm. And we all know that we've had some lot of work to be done.
I'd say one caveat, Mr. Chair, is that Greenwood also doesn't run its own utilities. We're kind of unique in that, and so that's why I asked that question earlier, and that was the intent of that USB resolution back whenever, is you got a $25 million entity here, you got a 27 here, you got a $50 million enterprise. And so I understood the theory behind paying out of utilities for the controller. I like the way that it's done now, but just for parity, you've got a controller that's running not only a utility but also a city government, whereas Greenwood doesn't. That controller doesn't have anything to do with the utilities. Mm-hmm. And I can't speak for the other municipalities, but like Anderson ran, the utility was under the mayor in Anderson? Or was it not?
It became under the controller's purview in the last 2.5 years.
How many folks do we have that works in our communications department?
Communications, we have 14 full-time employees and 2 part-time.
Okay. I noticed on this, the reason I asked is that the salary range was so broad. Right. Am I looking at that correctly? From 12 to 21. And so I didn't know how that was set up. I assume on the top end, that's considering like their supervisor or something over there?
No, if you look down below, there is a team leader tech pay for communications, the bottom of that page. My guess is that range was probably as wide as it is simply based on experience. We do have some that are at the higher end of that range, but we definitely have some that are not.
Oh, okay, I see that. So it's an additional $2 on top of the range for whoever is the manager over there. You know, we talk about the technical pay for a commercial driver's license. I assume that's the street department guys or something that,
It would be pretty, I think almost exclusively them.
All right. I'll be honest with you, when you talk about demand, CDL guys, good CDL guys are hard to get and keep. And we only have a 40-cent differential for those guys. 48-cent. That's interesting, isn't it? Okay. Counselors, do you have any other questions? Well, Mr. Fenwick, at this time, I am not prepared to entertain a motion of recommendation on this. I think that we need to look at the budget. I think we need to look at the budget a little further before I feel comfortable to entertain a motion for recommendation for approval for this increase. We'll have to make a motion on that. Is this a statement? No.
Unless there's someone wants to make a motion, there's no motion on the floor.
No. All righty. Okay. If there's no further questions, I'd like to move on to the next proposal, which is proposal number 18, which is fixing salaries for appointed officers and employees.
And ordinance number 18 is for... it's a public safety salary ordinance, so this is police and fire. The ranges are up 3%. It's about the that is the change.
You guys have, counselors have any questions related to this ordinance? No. I would entertain a motion on this one.
I'll second that.
Okay. So we would, so there's a motion to recommend approval to the council for public safety 3% raise. We'll make the recommendation to the council.
We need to have a vote.
Oh, all in favor, sorry. Any opposed? All right, motion carries. All right, here's Mr. Fenwick. I think this is going to be an easy one here. Proposal number 20, appropriation and tax rates for the budget for 2017. Could you please just give us a little explanation, just to kind of explaining this a little further, but just for the record.
This is literally the budget ordinance. So this is the proposal for 2017 as by fund, where we are as a whole, where we are proposing to spend for next year. So this is everything that the council would be entertaining between now and mid-October for funding for next year.
Okay. Now, I do have a question on, did you publish the budget today?
It has not been published yet. The public hearing is October 3rd. We have 10 days prior to the public hearing to post the advertisement. I was planning on either doing it when we get back tonight or first thing tomorrow morning. So we're still within that 10-day window.
Oh yeah, yeah. And you guys don't need to make a recommendation on this either yet. The Finance Committee clearly ready to make a full recommendation on the budget.
Yeah.
Mr. Fenwick, I know Councilor Shevlin and Councilor Freeman have seen different style of budget ordinance in the past, and this one's a little bit different. And you and I had a conversation.
Sure.
You want to kind of explain why we together thought this made sense?
Correct. So last year, the state mandated there's a standard budget ordinance that has to be submitted through Gateway. It can't be in any other form than their standard form. And so this is that standard Gateway form. The only difference is if you go onto Gateway now and look at that form of ordinance, it says adopted budget underneath the columns. And I haven't been comfortable last year or this year presenting something that says adopted when it hasn't been adopted. So I've kind of made this one to say proposed, but whatever the final budget becomes, you know, we will input that into Gateway. The council will sign that form of ordinance at the mid-October meeting, but we don't have a choice but to submit this form of ordinance through Gateway. We can pass something different, but then we still have to have this ordinance executed and signed by council to submit. So I think most, at least in my experience, that's what this is, the form of ordinance we now have to use.
And for the good of the order, I concur with that. There's certainly things if you wanted to do, you could, but we're going to have to pass an ordinance that meets the Keystone budget anyway, so you might as well at least see it in that form.
I think that we need to go ahead and keep this into committee until we can, because we can pass this after we have, after the budget is published and after we've made a decision on what the final budget is going to be, then we can pass this.
Go ahead, Councilor Shabbat.
Is that correct?
I mean, we can't pass, we have to pass this before we adopt a budget. As a committee, you're going to have to advertise the budget. So the question, I think, for the controller tonight is, are you okay with him advertising the budget as he's proposed? And if you're okay with that, I think make a motion to do that. He can go ahead and advertise the budget as presented to you all with some authority from this committee. And then in terms of what you actually do with your budget, you do not have to make a decision on that until you actually adopt the budget at the mid-October meeting. So do you need to pass something before the public hearing? No, you just need to make sure that you give him the authority to publish it. So when you have a public hearing, people know what the budget is before you. Right. Once published, you cannot increase line items. You can only decrease line items. The way the city ordinances work on salaries too, just so we're clear, this body can decrease ordinances, but you cannot, or decrease salaries, but you cannot increase them based on what was presented to you. So that's kind of your purview within.
When we also have that, some of those dates that are within the DLGF that we cannot miss, otherwise we revert back to the previous levy, which.
The statute is you have to have this adopted by November 2.
Yeah.
So if it's not, well, it has to be to DLGF by November 2. So November 1 is your cutoff date, and we've backed that up to the mid-October meeting. So our advice, and this is for me, and I'm speaking for the controller too, is let's get that done by the mid-October meeting. We have some leeway if we need it, but let's shoot for that date. And you still have time. I mean, we have a meeting next or this week, and then the first of the month meeting, and then one more council meeting. Mm-hmm.
If I can just add to that, there are 10-day separations between the adoption date, the public hearing date, and then the advertisement date. If we stick to those previously planned October 3rd for public hearing and October 19th for adoption, then the window to advertise is literally right now.
Well, I want to make sure that everyone has this understanding. And I want to make sure I'm on a correct understanding. You can't increase the budget once it's published. Correct. So that also means, though, that you can't move. Can you move money around?
You can move within a fund.
Within a fund. So if there's money within the general fund, you can move it within, but you can't. This is literally what will be published.
Right.
So you can't have a general fund adoption that's over $21 million. It's over $20 million.
Right. So that's a good question. So one of my concerns, I want to make sure, one of my concerns is I would like for us to consider or take a look at utilizing the internal services fund for those mechanic positions. So would that be off the table if we publish the budget? because that is moving from one fund to another fund.
And I have not reviewed your budget in the detail to tell you how much is available in the internal services funds, so I defer to the controller. I presume the answer to that is if you want to have that money in there, you should advertise at that fund. But I don't know if the mechanics, I assume the mechanics aren't paid out of that fund and they're being paid out of the general fund. Is that right?
NVH fund.
NVH fund. RV.
My off-the-top answer is going to be, I guess number one, that's something that we have looked at going back to earlier this year. I'm not prepared at the moment to really be able to put the analysis in that I feel is necessary to actually be able to support that. As an example, we really need to know the total cost of that operation because it's not just salaries. It's also parts, other things that go into these repairs. And I am not prepared to be able to fully address that right now. So in the time frame that we have to advertise the budget, my answer would be, the answer is no, that I don't think I can add that to the internal service fund now. Doesn't mean that we can't continue to look at that, which we have been. And even though we may be advertising in the next couple of days, it's always on the table in my mind because we do need to look at that. We just haven't been able to prioritize that given the other things we've had going on other than, it becoming a topic on Friday.
So I guess this is my question or concern. I mean, I understand there's supplies and things to look at, but if we're starting with the salaries because that's the known, that could be a starting place in my mind. And why wouldn't we use the same methodology of percentage of budget that we did when we did Corporation Council and everything else that we placed in the Internal Services Fund?
My concern there is that there are other precedents that have been set for garage in other cities where they do more of a literally as if you're a service shop, and if you come in and a vehicle's in service for 3 hours, then that's why we need this time in materials and parts analysis. I personally believe State Board has seen a garage distribution model before, and that's what they would want to see from us. The method we've proposed for these others have been used elsewhere in terms of percent of budget, so I feel that's why we need to have a more in-depth analysis of what goes on at the garage, and quite frankly they need to be able to write a service order in essence, if an apparatus or whatever it may be is in there for 3 hours, literally fill out the form and say 3 hours, here are the parts, no different than if you take it to a service shop.
Right. I think, though, I hear you. I think it's not going to be very difficult because when you say that, I know I have a very close friend that has a garage. And when he repairs something, he always tells me, I see him go over to the computer and says, the computer says that's a 3-hour job. The part costs this. This is what I'm going to charge you. So, I mean, there's software out there for those guys to do that. It's very common. My question, though, is when you said the estimation of parts and all this stuff, how did you budget it now? I mean, like, if you don't know any of the information, how did you go about setting a budget for them now?
Well, the street department looks at what they've used in the past, and, I mean, it is an estimate. I mean, if we, spent, pick a number on parts the last year or two, that's what they would budget for this year or for next year. That isn't, at least in the discussions I've had, broken down into, 10% of it was, parks or pick a department. This is how much we spent.
One point of clarification I should offer as your counsel is, yes, on the budget, we can't increase the numbers. We can always do an additional appropriation, though. So if it's not something that works within the budget schedule, and I hear the controller saying he's not comfortable to do that tonight, but you may all have a proposal, and that's fine, but we can do an additional appropriation at any time after the budget's adopted. So if we come around November and say, the controller says, hey, I've got those numbers for you now, we could fix it in the future. So, but that'll be after you've already adopted a budget saying otherwise. So just for a point of clarification, with this particular document, once they're advertised, the numbers can't go up, but you can amend your budget by doing additional appropriations, which just requires a new public hearing and what we've been, the process we've been through.
You know, and Councilor Chavis can chime in on this as well, as our concern and the whole real purpose of this is our street department could be funded better, right? Because we have needs, and those are things that, so for the street department to absorb cost that really should probably be the police department's cost, or the fire department's cost, or the parks department cost, it's really unfair to them. And I think unfair to the citizens of Lawrence. I asked in the last council meeting if you had the salaries of those guys, because we don't know how much money we're really talking about that kind of belongs to those guys.
It's in the budget book here. Its proposed budget is $569,000.
Right, but how much of it is the three?
Mechanics. Well, if there's
the three mechanics.
If there's $569 for personal services under regular, and there's three people, I don't think that they make $175,000 apiece. Right. But that's a pretty healthy number.
It's around 40 position.
40,000 a position.
Correct. And I don't disagree with you on, you know, addressing all of the, if a department's using a service, every department needs to pay for the service they're using. Like I said, I personally think there needs to be more detail involved for the garage in particular, to their, you know, having a system in place to fully track their time per department based on other precedents out there. And so I agree that we need to address this. I didn't feel that I was able to do that at this point in time, but it is something that, you know, we have certainly discussed and want to address. Couldn't do everything at once.
Okay, can I ask you this question then? when you look at the budget, if you look right here at oil, yeah, 1,000 for oil, 6,000 for tires and tubes. And then you have 18,000 on an other. There it is. Repair parts garage, $75,000 plus repair parts other, $38,000. That's the parts for the vehicles for the city.
That would be some of it, yes.
Because I do know that I was told that they also, oh, small tools. So the small tools and minor equipment would be what they do for their, they repair lawnmowers and things like that as well for the city. So basically, and you said that's some of it. So where's the rest of it? So, I mean, are we allocating some of that cost in somewhere else?
No.
So
if
then
it's garage related, it comes out of...
Out of those two right there. So, okay.
But that kind of, to me, therein lies the problem, because even within those categories, most of that should be vehicle related, but, you know, some of it's probably not. You know, just depending on the nature of the day-to-day activity of the street department. Like I said, I would want to have a better idea, at least on history, how much of the street department's time from a maintenance of vehicles, as an example standpoint, has actually been spent on their vehicles versus other departments, and I just don't have a good understanding of that at the moment.
But we can say that we can say that approximately $233,000 out of their budget is for the salaries of those three mechanics and for the repair parts. Now, we don't know how much of that belongs to parks or police or fire.
Correct.
But we do know that we're spending $233,000 on paying mechanics and the parts. Do we know if we out? I'm assuming that they don't do all repairs on our vehicles. Like if there's some major overhauls,
they don't do it all. And I, at least in the time that I've been here, depending on the nature of what is going on, departments have picked up repairs that have been outside of the city. I can't say that's, you know, with 100% certainty either. Right.
So back to the ordinance 20-2016. I think my concern is jeopardy of missing our advertising timelines as well as our public hearing. And given the fact that we always have the privilege to go back and reappropriate and relook at this budget as we've already done this year several times. So,
and if I could add to the worst case scenario, if we were to revert, which is we've missed an advertising deadline, the public hearing, or the adoption, number one, we don't get the property tax levy growth, which was 3.8% from 16 to 17. There's also additional co-op growth due to the levy rising as well. So from a revenue standpoint, it is not insignificant if we miss the deadlines and the pain, if you will, that Lawrence will feel, because we'll lose the levy growth for property taxes and the potential COAT growth. So we're probably looking at the levy growth alone is about $400,000 from 16 to 17. And then the COAT growth, which is conservative, is probably at least another $100,000 or $200,000. So anywhere from $500,000 or $600,000 in lost revenue if those deadlines are missed.
Right. So for clarity's sake, though, the deadline for us to approve this ordinance, if we don't do it on Wednesday, our next council meeting is?
We don't even need to approve it on Wednesday. You just need to give him the green light to advertise.
Advertise.
Yeah.
Right. We're within the time frame to get that done still if you approve an advertising date tonight. If you don't approve an advertising date tonight and the budget is not advertised, then we'll have to push some deadlines back on public hearing and things of that nature, or may have to.
Okay.
I mean, I'm fine with this, you know, moving forward, but I do want to put that out there because that is a concern of mine, and I would like us to, I think out of the shared services, that's a big bucket of money, and I think that our streets and our citizens could benefit probably from 3 or 4 additional part-time employees with that money. I mean, you know, it's real jobs and would make a real difference for our city. So I would like to see us take a look at it, and I just wanted to be on record as saying that. I'm not saying that that's going to stop us from advertising, that I want to stop us from advertising the budget, but I do want to go on record as saying that I don't want us to just put that to the side. I want us to really take a look at how we can accomplish it, because I do think it'll make a huge difference.
Well, we can't accomplish it this year.
Well, we can't accomplish it through this budget ordinance.
Through this budget ordinance. Yeah.
Right.
One of the mechanisms the controller's talking about, the State Board of Accounts does have a fund they identify as the garage fund that's set up specifically for this purpose. Now, it's not, We could probably do it through a home ruled fund and do it through the administrative services or internal services funds, but there is, the State Board of Accounts does have a mechanism called a garage fund that the city could look into adding, and we could add that fund and then do an additional appropriation and transfer money and...
So we can add that fund after the budget has been adopted and all that?
You could.
Just an amended budget.
You just have to do a new we have to go through the additional appropriation process. And I would note that while you can do an additional appropriation this year, effective for next year, we won't really know what our budget is officially till DLGF approves it. So we really should wait till after DLGF approval before doing anything.
And I guess I wanted to go on record with it too, because I wanted to make sure that that was a consideration as we're looking at other areas of the budget, that, you know, if hypothetically it is 60, 70 grand for police, 40 for fire, I'm just throwing numbers out there, you know, that could impact other areas of their budget. So I just...
Okay. All right. So I would entertain a motion for us to make a recommendation to the council. Well, actually, a motion to publish our budget.
Second.
All right. All in favor? Opposed? All right. So you can get it published.
Go forth and publish.
All right. Other items. I do have one other item that I want to bring to the to the committee tonight for discussion, and it is our pilot payment, contractual utility payment, surplus fund payment, however or that you guys would like to discuss this or categorize it. And so what if we look at our budget here, something we can discuss, guys, is that $3.1 million of our budget is coming from the, is a payment from the utilities. And so I am personally very concerned about the fiscal health of our utility in that amount of that payment coming to the city at the detriment of the utility. So my question, I guess, to our controller, Mr. Fenwick, is I have a couple questions, if you don't mind, concerning this payment. My first question to you is if this payment... Well, first of all, you're going to start on working on the utility budget soon.
Correct.
Okay. So if this payment being at 3.1, where does that number come from? That amount.
When you say where does it come from?
Mm-hmm. Why 3.1?
So there's a... Give me a second.
State statute code, I believe.
There's a, in my understanding, a contract that's been in place since, call it 2001, but at least the payment amounts from the utility to the city began with a half a payment in 01, and then from 02 on, it lays out a schedule at least through the year 2021. And then it has all years after that with an amount. Mm-hmm. That spells out the amount to be paid by water. And water, as an example, for 2017 says 1.3 million. And sewer for 2017 says 2 million and some change.
Yeah. So you said that it's a, what did you say it was again that mandated this payment?
My understanding is the contract between the utility and the city. utilities in the city.
Okay. Well, there was a contract agreement set by the Lawrence Utility who had purchased the city to make that payment. Then in 2009, the utility did a resolution to continue those payments throughout to honor the schedule. The USB did it to honor the schedule for up to 2021. But that was to pay as long as the city needed the money. If you look at the ordinance, I don't know if anyone else has seen that ordinance on that payment. So that is not, it's not by statute, it's not, has to happen. It's a utility USB resolution that was written and signed. So it's something that we don't have to do. I guess my question to you is, as the controller of the utility, do you feel like the utility is healthy enough to make this payment?
The utilities have not been healthy enough to make this payment for a few years. We're working to address this payment. On the flip side, I don't believe the city can afford to not receive it right now. So we have a challenge to address this, and we're planning to do that. But right now, I don't believe it's in the city's best interest to not accept this.
So it's in the best interest of the utility to pay it?
Excuse me?
You said it's half a dozen. So 1 minute you said the city is not in the position to not accept the money.
Correct.
But the utility is not in the position.
Nor have they been.
Years. But I was elected January 2016. Nor in a position to pay the payment. So what is the plan to make it whole?
I believe we need to begin reducing it. And that's the plan in terms of a full evaluation of our utilities and what do our utilities need. From an operations standpoint, a capital standpoint, we need to look at their asset values to see, we've been doing this for several months, but it's a pretty lengthy process in terms of evaluating the utility. I think once we've identified what the utility's needs are, next year we can begin, you know, exploring not only that side, but then how we can start to slowly reduce the city's reliance on that payment. But to suggest we could do it overnight, it would be, in my opinion, it'd be a disaster for the city right now.
If you addressed it wholly.
Correct.
Right. And I agree with you. There would be. In 2012, there was a study done by Crowe Harworth. Have you seen that?
I've seen parts of it, yes.
Okay. Do you know what the, and so it suggested that the utility should be receiving $1.4 million as a pilot payment.
If you base the calculation on their analysis then, which they assumed it would be a pilot, so they did a payment in lieu of taxes calculation, and you know at that point in time, based on their analysis, yeah, that's the number they came up with.
It's $1.4 million.
I would like to add that the assets that they used in that analysis were from 2010. There certainly have been improvements made to the utility since then. Based on what I've seen, and I'm not saying their analysis is incorrect, because they were provided those asset numbers by the city. I'm not sure if I have a high degree of confidence in those asset values, because the ledgers I've seen, we haven't updated those in years, and so that's in part what we've been doing, is working to have those updated.
So you think it could be off $1.5 million?
At this point, I can't answer how off. It could be understated or overstated or spot on. I can't answer.
Mm-hmm. My next question to you related to the payment is how do we've been audited and cited by State Board of Accounts. I noticed, how many, have you addressed all the issues on the audit?
Wouldn't say I've addressed all of them, but we're addressing as many as we can in the timeframe that we can. So there are still some that have not been addressed.
Could you tell me which ones have not been addressed?
Off the top of my head, I believe one of the findings was related to bad debts and a policy on collections for that. We haven't, we've made some progress, but, to say we've addressed it, no. This payment was one that, at this point we have not addressed, but are working on that, no different than bad debts. Those are the two that come to mind. I think there may be one other one, but not, remembering it off the top of my head.
Bank reconciliation.
We've... I'd say we've made significant progress on that, okay. But to say that we're done, no.
Okay.
Because that's a very, in fact, that's been the number one priority because really until we get that reconciliation done, that really tells us where everything is at that point.
So I guess, Mr. Fenwick, what is the plan on addressing the pilot?
I don't have one at the moment. All I can say is, it's certainly something we have been working on. We don't have all the facts, in my opinion, to be able to fully address it, but we are going to get those and we will address it. But right now, I don't have a plan.
And what is the facts that are needed?
We need a rate analysis on the utilities. Again, the asset values, there's a lot of information we don't have that we need to be able to really evaluate the utilities. We didn't have financials up until probably May of this year for the last handful of years, so we quite frankly didn't even know what the situation at the utility was.
And the USB votes on that pilot payment too, correct? So they've been voting for the last 5, 6, 7, whatever years since 2007?
Yes.
Yes. And so, but the bond rating dropped.
Yes.
So utility basically cannot do any projects right now because it can't borrow any money to do any significant projects.
The bond was downgraded last November, and yes, that's correct. They can't borrow right now.
So what you're telling me, Mr. Fenwick, is that we do know that we may not know the details, but we do know that the utility is in financial trouble. It cannot borrow any money to do any projects. We know we have crumbling infrastructure issues, but we're going to continue to accept the payment from them that they're not mandated to pay because the city side is more important than clean water and sewage to our citizens.
I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying we're working on it and we're going to address it. You're putting words into my mouth right now by that comment, and that is not a true statement. If you drop the water payment to zero, it doesn't change the current water operation scenario. They're going to be in the same position they are now if you make it zero.
So if we gave the utility back $3 million,
it's not
going to change their bond rating?
No, it would not. $3 million, number one, isn't coming from water.
Water and sewer, the whole utility total, 1.4 and 400 and some thousand.
If that were zero today, it does not change the condition of the water utility.
But you can say that adamantly, but you don't know the whole story of it to correct it, but you know that $3.1 million.
That's a pretty easy answer, yes.
It's not going to fix it. It wouldn't make it healthier.
No.
So it's in really bad shape if it's paying out $3 million, and that
water's not
helping.
Paying out $3 million. Let's be clear on that. Water's not paying out $3 million. We're only referring to water right now.
The whole utility as a whole, water and sewage, as a whole. I mean, if you want to split it, tell me how much water's paying.
I just did. I told you it was for 2017. Water was $1.3 million.
And then how much is sewage then?
Sewers would be the difference. $2 million and some changes.
$2 million.
I said about 5 minutes ago.
Right. So, but the utility is one entity.
you were referring to water, and I have been addressing water.
I'm really referring to the payment that's being paid to the city of Lawrence. I don't see two separate payments coming. It comes as one payment.
No, it does not.
It doesn't.
It comes from water and comes from sewer.
Well, in your budget general fund, when you in here, it's showing payment from utilities of $3.1 million.
Yeah, utilities is plural.
Plural. But why does it, I don't understand why, for the basis of this discussion, I understand that there's a sewer side, there's a water side. I get that.
Water was the one downgraded to junk.
Okay.
Water is the one that can't borrow. Sewer can borrow.
Sewer can borrow.
Correct.
I didn't know that. Thank you. What is in both of them are in need of repairs?
That's an ongoing discussion period for utilities.
I did not know that. And thank you for the clarity. That's water can borrow.
Water cannot borrow.
I mean, the water cannot borrow, but sewer can. If we decided to receive less money as a good faith effort to moving forward in correcting this, what sort of impact would it have on your budget?
We've presented a balanced budget, so we would no longer have a balanced budget.
And you have to have a balanced budget.
I think it's the prudent financial decision to make is to have a balanced budget.
Didn't you tell me by statute the cities have to have a balanced budget?
You can't spend more money than you have unless you borrow it.
So right.
You have to have revenue from somewhere. Mm.
I have no further.
But you could, as a council, if you reduce a revenue item, reduce your expenses by an equal amount, and therefore have a balanced budget. But the question is, what would you reduce? That'd be the question.
I guess the other question too, and you're probably not in a position to answer right now, $2 million. Let me make sure I have my numbers correct. If I wrote it down correctly, I want to make sure I'm correct. $1.3 million being paid by sewer. So what you just said?
Water.
And $2 million by sewer. If we return the $1.3 million to water, they still would be in a junk bond rating.
Yep.
So what needs to be done to pull our water out of a junk bond rating?
Number one, it's a lengthy process to pull them out of a junk rating. It's not going to happen overnight. Even if the water all of a sudden is, printing money, it's not going to happen overnight. Number one, rating agencies look at a variety of things when they either move a rating up or move a rating down. One of the things when they move a rating down is the financial condition of the utility, number one, which would warrant, in this case, a downgrade. And two is willingness to raise rates. Rates have to be raised in a prudent manner for all utilities because of the capital intensive nature of that business, not just in Lawrence, but everywhere. And if there's not a willingness to raise rates, that impacts the rating as well. So you have to have a combination of those factors in place. And even if those were all in place today, they're not going to simply raise it overnight because then they want to see that it's sustained. Maybe you had to raise the rates a certain percent now. Are you going to do it in a year or two, when you need it again? So there are a variety of factors that will come into effect, to impact that rating.
I guess you would say, in your professional opinion, I mean, it doesn't matter now, but as we're learning, it took a long time for it to go to junk, and it's going to take a while for it to come out.
Correct.
So it should have been, I understand, so it should have been addressed sooner, not Correct. To get to junk.
Correct.
But the longer we procrastinate, the longer it...
I wouldn't say we're procrastinating, it takes time. I mean, this should have been, to your point, done well before now.
Right.
Nothing was done before now, and it takes time to fully analyze the system, what capital you need. You don't just want to knee-jerk it and say, eyeballing, we need, you know, pick a percent. You know, we got to be able to justify it. And that involves, I mean, that's a lengthy process, and that's been ongoing.
I still, though, differ with you in opinion that if something's dying, I give it oxygen. I just don't keep taking from it.
Mr. Chair, I have one quick question on this, if I may. Jason, you mentioned earlier that for several years, the utility were not providing financials. Do you have any idea of what the USB was approving every year for a budget if they weren't given financials?
I don't know. I've seen some of the sheets in the past. It was a one-page budget, but in terms of a detailed, we're very close to having monthly financials going forward. I mean, that should have been in place because that would have shown the condition of the utility, and that was not.
So is a payment, is it approved by the USB and the council?
Just USB.
Just the USB?
Yes.
Yes.
In terms of the 3.1, so if you go back and look at the original resolution, a little history on sort of how this payment came about, as I understand it, Lawrence Utilities LLC was the operator for Lawrence Utilities, the Lawrence Utilities, and in 2007 there was a lawsuit and a settlement agreement came out of all that lawsuit. Part of that settlement agreement was to transfer operation and control from Lawrence Utilities LLC to the Utility Service Board. At that time, the Utility Service Board accepted certain of the agreements within that settlement agreement as binding. The agreement, which the payment came out of, was the third amended and restated operating agreement. That was not technically attached to the settlement agreement, as here's the agreements we're going to follow. The reason for that, in my opinion, is because since you're now one entity, the obligations merge. And so at that time, the USB adopted a new resolution. It's resolution number one, their first one. And what they said was they will continue to make the payment until such time that the city and Utility Service Board determine they are no longer necessary. Now, so the question is, it's really for both entities, in my opinion, based on the Utility Service Board's resolution. And that, of course, the Utility Service Board is essentially paying a bill. They're essentially paying you a contractual or a pilot or something. So if you told the Utility Service Board, hey, your bill is only $2 million, I can't imagine that they would pay more than that. But I think it's both entities. But this entity has a say in what you ultimately do with what you accept as a revenue item.
I have one further question on this, and I'll leave it alone. When the utility, is the utility paying for services that it receives from the city?
When you say that, I mean, like right now?
You mean like IT?
I mean like IT, controller, is it paying its...
It's not paying its fair share. I think, you know, what's been going on this year and in years past, salaries have been allocated, you know, general fund, utilities in some percentage basis. So in that regard, you know, which is why, again, on these internal services funds to distribute those costs to all departments, not just general fund and utility, that's the primary intent with those. An operational standpoint in those, I would say the utilities have not paid their fair share. On the flip side, you know, take IT as an example. Last year, utilities paid, by and large, 100% of salaries and the contracts for those. So they paid more than their fair share. The proposal in this 2017 budget would be having every department pay their fair share for those services, not just a utility or something else.
So for 2017, the way that we're setting up, the utility would pay its share like every other department, or I know it's not really a department, but you know, but by everyone else into the internal service fund, for the services that it's using.
Correct.
Right. So what does the utility get with its $3 million that it pays?
You know, quite frankly, every municipality that I am aware of, I came from Anderson. Anderson had four utilities. Those four utilities made a payment to the city, which was separate from sharing costs. And same analysis was done there as far as salaries and everything else.
So utility pays for its services that it does. Then it pays this fee, contract, slush fund, whatever you want to call it, to the city. So really, in reality, and I'm not saying we don't know for 2017, but in past, if it paid 100% of IT, our IT bill was what, $600,000-$700,000 or something of that sort, right? Mm-hmm. Then it paid portions of people's salaries, right? So would it be fair to say that the utility was paying $5 million in that direction with the pilot and the other fees?
It'd be close.
Right. Right.
I don't know what the number is.
Right, but I'm saying. And the utility is still running barely in the black, right?
Well, sewer's in the black, water is not.
It is in the red, okay.
And we'll repeat, it has been in the red for several years.
Right, but, you know. Okay, I just...
I'd like to make a motion for adjournment, because I can't take any more utility talk.
I'll second that.
I didn't ask for it, though.
Don't need to ask for it. She can make a motion.
Can I make a motion?
Yes, you can make a motion, and the chair can recognize the motion, and there's a second, and you can take a vote on that motion.
Do we need another finance meeting?
Do we have anything else to cover?
You will need another finance meeting since you have not passed out proposal 17 and 20. You'll need another finance committee meeting to make recommendations on those two proposals.
Mm-hmm. Motion for adjournment. All in favor? Disapprove. Pass.